Good morning, Awake Radio. This is Chrissy McMahon, and I'm calling live from Bristol, or Ben Salem, I moved. Today, because I'm so fresh and ready, I had no idea that I was going to start so soon, and I'm so grateful. And I was checking out the chat, and I see people are just into a real metaphysical mood. I see emerald tablets off, and I really have limited information about that. So I thought I would start talking about distilled liquids because I think it's really on the forefront right now, especially with Awake Radio, and it's something that's very near and dear to my heart. I'm a big proponent of urine therapy and distilled liquids. So I'm not sure if anybody has any questions about it. I really like to talk about any kind of health issues that have to do with eating healthier, eating raw foods. Distilled liquids fit right in there because raw distilled juices from fruits and vegetables are right on top of the list. And then urine therapy is an extension of that distilled liquid therapy. So without further ado, I'd like to start by thanking my dear friend Andrew Norm Weber, who will be participating in a discussion there in the UK, I think next week. I don't have the information up right away. Maybe Mr. C could enlighten us with the exact details, but they're looking for people to participate in their little chat, and I think it's real important. I'll start this way. One of the things that I learned when I went to Vilcabamba, Ecuador in 2010 was there was this big issue around the acquisition of food based on what the government and the corporations were doing that would limit our ability to access food and clean drinking water. A lot of people that I was in contact with at the time were discussing moving to below the equator, south of the equator, because they were very concerned about the situation of the police state and the quality of food and water in the northern hemisphere. So I went to Vilcabamba. Basically, I was checking it out, trying to see if that would be a place that I would be interested in moving to. And I could sense the fear, although it was 12 days of pure love and joy talking about alternative community and education on food and nutrition, all kinds of curatives, gardening, creating your own medicines and things like that. It was just a wonderful, wonderful time and great experience. But I could still feel the underlying sense of that fear. People weren't sure what's going to happen. And in 2010, I think it was less understood. And I think people were more getting into the information and not really knowing where to go with it. So when I stumbled upon Andrew and his information on urine therapy, it really just lightened the burden. It gave me the opportunity to realize that I carry my own source of nutrition and health and well-being with me wherever I go. So that was the first thing that came to my mind, and I was so set at ease. I no longer thought about moving to the southern hemisphere. It just didn't seem necessary, that I could go anywhere and I could feel safe and secure. So I think that would be the most important message, that as far as distilled liquids are concerned, whether you drink your own urine or you use fruits and vegetables or distilled water as your source of sustenance, that that you don't have to worry, that there's ways and methods to make this accessible and easy to use. The biggest problem some people might have would be trying to find water that's clean and then having to distill it. Then the finding clean, fresh, organic fruits and vegetables that they could make into curative drinks, distilled drinks. So with that said, that was my education into distilled liquids and urine therapy. Then I learned some of the major aspects of urine therapy were that it's one of the key secrets of most models. Some of the top models in the beauty contest, the World Universe, the Miss America contest. In fact, we met Miss New York while we were there in 2010. Actually came to our little 12-day community gathering. That she told us that placing urine on your skin actually helps to make your skin look younger. And as I learned from listening to Andrew Norton Weber, was that as a baby living in your mother's womb, that you go the first 3 months, you're saturated with your mother's urine, and in the last 6 months of your gestation, that's basically your own urine. So without that urine within your system, your lungs don't develop, your body doesn't develop, you know, your brain, everything's floating in urine. So having that understanding, I think, really goes far to help people get a sense of how beneficial urine is, and not just have this opposition to the fact that, oh, it's a waste product, or oh, it smells, or, you know, whatever. Part of the reason why your urine smells is because of the food that we eat. A lot of us eat cooked food, and I've desperately been trying to have just a whole raw food diet, but because of the nature of my work, I'm eating fast food. I'm eating things that, you know, I would never make for myself, but because I feel that the need to imbibe on something, I'll go and I'll buy different. Okay, I just got a message. I was checking it. I'll buy things that I don't really want to mention. We have a place called Wawa, and I'll get meatball sandwiches, which I'm not regularly a meat eater. I don't think I've eaten chicken or turkey for like the last past year, and red meat. I've basically been off of it for the most part for years. I was married to a man who had a heart condition, so we really didn't even eat beef or pork for 17 years. But I found out from Andrew too that you can eat whatever you want and drink distilled water, and it'll flush out whatever impurities are going on inside of your body. So with that in the back of my mind, I have fed into my sensual desires to eat things that are probably not in my best health or interest, but doing it on a periodical and not a continued basis. So that's basically how I've been living the last past year, trying to walk the walk that I talk, but also living in this construct that I haven't been able to escape for myself as yet. And so I'm kind of stuck with the sensations of wanting to eat. And when you eat that kind of cooked food, you, I think you set up the conditions to want to have the desired more, not to mention the MSGs and the preservatives and the cornstarch and whatever else they put in. You know, my daughter and I, a few years back looked up, the ingredients in McDonald's food, and we found that, sugar in the form of dextrose and fructose and, whatever else toast that they make today, is even prevalent in the burgers. They put it in everything, French fries, the salads, they sprinkle it on the salads and powdered, I don't know. But it's in everything they make at McDonald's. So, those kind of ingredients are kind of, highly addictive. And I think they set up that condition to where we have that hunger, empty feeling. And I think that's also part of, the construct of cooked food. And I have this personal theory, and I rarely talk about it with anybody. And I think I wrote a short little blog on Blogger that cooked food is akin to carrion. And, you know, although we turn our noses up to dead animals on the side of the road, I think by the time most of us cook the meals that we eat, our food is basically in the same state that, you know, a dead animal on the side of the road is. It doesn't have nutrients because most of them are cooked out, and any healthful benefits that we may have gotten from the food when it was alive are essentially steamed away or just have been evaporated through the cooking process. So although, you know, we can have the most beautiful meals prepared and, you know, and they look attractive and they taste wonderful, essentially the nutritional value is very low or non-existent. So with that knowledge, I really try to focus on the distilled liquid, the raw food diet, and urine therapy as being my primary sources of nutrition. Something else that I really want to put out there, and because I don't think it's talked about as much, and I think it's kind of looked at as being on fringe more than urine therapy, is breatharians. We also met breatharians when we were in Vilcabamba. Akai and his wife Camelia was pregnant. And she wasn't eating throughout her gestation. And she went to the doctors with the sole purpose of getting baseline nutritional and blood work done to make sure that, you know, everything was healthy and just for her own consciousness to know, you know, what exactly she was doing with her health and her baby's health. And throughout the 9 months, it was found that her health and her baby's health was better than the other women who were in her doctor's care, who were eating regular diets, probably taking nutritional supplements such as iron and vitamins. And you can find her interview on, I think it's called The Juicy Tour with Lilo Mace. And, her name's Camelia and her husband's name's Akai. I don't remember their last name, but I can get that information too while I'm talking, and people can look at her interview. And well, anyway, I came to the conclusion that I think food eating might be a construct, and I think that's something I would really like to research more into and find out. And everybody's talking about the Paleolithic diet, that when we didn't eat agricultural grains and vegetables and things like that, that we had a healthier diet. And I tend to think that that's false because I really look at the breatharians, and there's many people that you can just go and Google on the internet and you can read and watch their story and watch their progress, how they live, their health. And I would really like to research what was the diet before agriculture, before the Paleolithic, like, before fire was discovered. You know, did people really eat? When people lived to be 900, 1,000 years, as was recorded in the Bible, which may or may not be true, did people really eat? We also know that, we can absorb water right through our skin. There's been plenty of studies that show that people who go on fasting diets, they never seem to deplete their fluid intakes because we can gather moisture right through our skin. The largest organ of our body has the ability to do that and process it. I'd like to think that I know we're told that osteoporosis is a function of not getting enough calcium in our body, but I tend to think, just through my own limited research and understanding of distilled liquids and health and nutrition, that on the basis of the cooked food diet and the supplements that we're encouraged to imbibe of, that that's probably more of a factor in osteoporosis, especially for women, than it is a benefit. So I think there is probably more evidence if I had access to that kind of a laboratory to study those kind of things, that the basic diet of an American and now would be any country in the developed world, probably does more detrimental effects to the health and well-being of people, of the human body, than what we're learning about distilled liquids and raw food diets. So with that said, back to Vilcabamba and my great friend Andrew Norton Weber, who introduced me to distilled liquids and urine therapy. One of the first things after I learned from the beauty queens the secret of the curative properties of urine therapy, I found out that urine therapy is actually a 5,000-year-old practice both in Egypt and China and in India. There's several documents that are over 5,000 years old that speak to the use of urine therapy. There's especially ancient Egyptian papyruses that speak to the use of urine therapy and how it was kept secret. Without getting on to that, I know that the ancient Chinese and even modern Chinese collect gallons of their own urine in the event that a child would be burned, which is a normal thing that happens, not so much today because we're more safety conscious in developed nations, but in China, I guess children were left unsupervised around hot cooked food and would scald themselves, and they would be wrapped in rags soaked with urine that was aged. The alkaline nature of the aged urine was so curative that by the time the children would be healed, their skin would be healed, it would be as if they had no scars. And today we know that medical practices, they use silvodyne paste, and one of the processes is to continually scrub the skin to exfoliate and stimulate new skin growth when anybody goes through a burn process, when anybody's skin's damaged at the second or third degree burns, that's part of the process that they use in hospitals. And they recommend when people go home that they actually scrub their skin and try to stimulate skin growth. Or they have skin grafts or whatever. Never is it ever purported or promoted that urine therapy. And I just looked on my YouTube site, which is Bapsha Means Love. I think if you just look up Andrew Norton Weber on distilled liquid, you'll find the link to Bapsha Means Love YouTube page. And some of the statements underneath the video from people who viewed my interviews with him asked the question and then made the statement that they used it for a burn. They used urine therapy for urine on their burn and found that it healed them miraculously, wonderfully, magically, I think were the terms that the person used. And I had to chime in that when I was in Vilcabamba, I had over second degree, I think I was blistered on my face and my chest from sitting out with this gentleman, Akai, did a meditation, a healing meditation with us. And I was under a tree, and I guess it was October, and I assumed that the October sun at the equator wasn't quite as strong as the summer sun in the same location. And as it funneled through the leaves, while I lie on my back in the meditation, I was severely sunburned, and I have pictures that are just hellacious to give evidence to it. And Andrew observed me using what was then all the rage during our little conference was alkaline water. And they had a machine that was adding whatever to make this alkaline water. And I was spraying it with some essential oils on my face and my chest, which was very relieving. I think just the cool aspect of the liquid was relieving, but I don't know that it was creating any cure. And he came over and he said, why don't you try urine? And I looked at him and I really wasn't completely convinced at that point, but I was so in pain and sore from this, unexpected injury that I spent the rest of the evening, splashing my own urine on my face and my chest, like every couple, 30 minutes to 2 hours, and found that it was, the sensation of it was very soothing. It took away a lot of the pain that I was experiencing. And within 24 hours of doing that, of splashing the urine onto my skin and my face and my chest, I had the most beautiful tan that I have ever had in my life. And I'm very fair-skinned. I don't normally tan. I usually burn and peel. All throughout my whole life, I don't really remember tanning, although I've tried, with futility to do it through my teenage years and through my 20s, but it never had the success. And not that I would recommend doing that for anybody, but I found that the urine that I used was so curative and had such unexpected, wonderful benefits that I knew that no matter what, that was something that actually worked. So it gave more evidence. Then I came back and I was fortunate to interview, Andrew Norton Weber again on my, Blog Talk radio show and learned so much more about, how he came into the study of urine therapy and his trials and victories with urine therapy. And found that it's an overall lifestyle. It's not just, something that can be used when there's a specific symptom or problem, but there were so many, curative approaches, that could be made with urine therapy that urine therapy could basically be, applied to any disease or illness that anybody's suffering. With that said, Andrew has people that are right now, they were diagnostically, determined to have diabetes and, were taking insulin, and injections and we're going through this process of trying to heal through the medical system and got wind of, urine therapy and distilled liquids in general. And have been using that process and have been able to get off the medications and have documented the process over days, through blogs, through talking with him on the radio. There's all kinds of anecdotal evidence that's current, not just in books, but people are documenting their own healing processes. From people who, one of the things with diabetics is that they have, the skin breakdown. People actually, if they, hurt themselves in their extremities, they have difficulty healing as a result of the effects of diabetes. And, people have been able to heal themselves, throughout the process of using urine therapy and distilled liquids. And it's just amazing the evidence that we're collecting. And hopefully, Andrew will be able to write his book soon and we'll all have the privilege of being able to read, not only his experiences and his information, but also all these hundreds of people who are coming to him now and sharing this journey of, urine therapy and distilled liquids with us. So, it's amazing how this information is just, is going on to, benefit so many people in such a short time. My interview started in 2011 or the end of 2010, 2011, and have, in 2012, in less than, well, over 2.5 years, there's been hundreds of people who have jumped on the bandwagon, who have gotten this information, radio station hosts who have, tried to, people like Santos Bonacci, and, allegedly Dave, I'm not sure what his last name is, and Mr. Curative, you know, are some of the newer people who have, got on the bandwagon and maybe have in the past or just currently getting involved in this process that is, you know, freeing. People want to live in a free world. Well, guess what? Urine therapy, distilled liquids are definitely the path to free yourself from the madness of, the Agenda 21 that's being purported for the UN and also, in the United States, they're fighting, Proposition 34 in California to try to make GMOs, labeling on all food substances that, are processed, manufactured with, genetically modified organisms. So, I think that, you know, that we have something that we can do that's inside of us, that's curative, that's scientifically based. I mean, we're doing a scientific method. We're using people, actual people who are going through the process of using this method and coming up with excellent results, getting off their diabetic medications, you know, getting off of insulin. Their health being restored. Well, we know that diabetes is a curative disease. So why can't we, through the medical system, through the pharmaceutical system, why can't we be, inundated with evidence-based, methods and treatments that are curative, such as, distilled liquids, raw foods and urine therapy. So, I think it's up to us, and I think that that's why I chose to call my radio show Alchemical Connections, because I really want this to be an action process. I want it to be something that's interactive, not something that's just theoretically based, not something that we sit around and philosophize about, oh, this could work, oh, that. But, you know, we have evidence that that base that, you know, you can try this at home, get your own collection containers, you know, bottles, plastic, glass. I prefer glass myself. You know, as far as the beauty and health issues are concerned, the collection process would be to collect your own urine and let it sit for 7 days. So the longer it sits, the more alkaline the substance becomes, and for some reason, the more alkaline the substance, the more curative it is. So, you know, this is something that we can all do, you know, over the next couple weeks or a month, we can just start our collection and report, you know, on a weekly basis what the results are. We could post pictures, you know, this is my crow's feet before I started, my urine therapy beauty treatment, and 2 weeks down the line, these are the pictures of my crow's feet or the little line around my forehead or around my mouth or even my neck, which a lot of women have their neckline as we get older starts to crinkle for some unknown reason. And I tend to think it has to do with stimulation. My bathing process is I use a clean washcloth each time I take a shower. And I scrub as vigorously on my skin as possible. And I think that in itself, stimulates a change in the condition of my skin, eliminates that, that itchiness and dry flakiness of the skin, especially in the winter months. And I think also maintains the health of my skin in general. So I don't tend to use urine therapy as a beauty treatment, but more of a process of cleansing for fasting. I've used it when I haven't felt well to help me feel more up to myself, like with flu symptoms or anything like that. I found that when I have headaches, it's usually my body signaling to me that my fluid intake is too low. So I know that if I drink some urine or I drink excessive amounts of distilled liquid, especially water, distilled water, that within minutes or in less than half an hour, whatever symptoms I have of a headache, then I'm cured almost immediately. And I really haven't been able to use it for any other intensive, health problems. I know in 2000 I did have cancer, and as a result had a hysterectomy. I was told that the pathology showed that I had a uterine and cervical cancer, which some people are reporting through the health system on the mainstream medical establishment that HPV is one of the causes, but I was never diagnosed with the human papilloma virus, so I'm not sure what the development was. I can say this because my husband consequently died in 2010, that I was involved in a very emotionally and mentally abusive relationship. And it could be shown possibly that the effects of that relationship created the disease in my body. And it manifests as uterine and cervical cancer. So I don't know for sure. I went for a long time with the symptoms of that illness, and I was never offered any alternatives, and I had no idea in 2000 that there were any alternatives other than radiation and chemotherapy. And because of the nature of uterine cancer, and cervical cancer is considered a slow-growing process. That the treatment that I actually received as far as chemotherapy was the least invasive, if you can say that about chemotherapy. But the radiation treatment was much more severe and created a lot more damage in my body probably than the illness itself. If I had known that there were alternative treatments, there's the Gerson therapy, which is basically distilled liquids, drinking green apple and carrot juice. They have a whole litany of treatments that they recommend, and you can come to their facilities, I think, for free. Mostly people who have late stage or incurable cancer, are encouraged to participate, but you know, we don't have to let it go that far. We have treatments that are available, and urine therapy is definitely one of the things Andrew said, I think, on his first talk was, or maybe it was with me, I'm not sure, that it didn't matter that your urine was white, pussy, and whatever. I mean, you could be at the last stages of even renal or kidney failure, and that if you drank your urine, that there would be some curative processes in there, and that you would be able to cure yourself. Consequently, my stepdad died in 2011, not from bladder cancer, for which he had surgery, and they consequently removed all the cancer, within his bladder by cutting part of it out. But he died from cancer affecting his lungs and his liver and probably the rest of his body, which was never diagnosed because when he had the bladder cancer, the only thing that the medical system looked at was the bladder doctor looked at the bladder and no other parts of his body. So we don't know when or how the other cancers progressed in his body. He was in the military. He had a military career and was in Vietnam and was subjected to Agent Orange, which is a known factor in lung cancer. But we had no evidence of any other thing. And I spoke to my mother at length about urine therapy, about distilled liquids. And she was very hesitant. And I don't think she ever talked to her husband about it, who, coming from old school, probably talking about his bladder or anything, you know, probably would have offended him. And he was not as open to his own health. Unlike my own father, who died from, in 2006, I believe, or 2006, he died from complications with diabetes. He had been on, dialysis for 7 or 8 years, which, you know, I thought was unheard of, but apparently many people are on that treatment. And what it is your blood is cycled through distilled liquids and put back into your body. And it's just amazing that they'll go through all this meandering mechanical processes to it's not actually cure, but to sustain some semblance of health. But don't ever put two and three together and find that. And I guess it's the economical factor that they don't want people to heal themselves because then they wouldn't be making money. But I'm sure that instead of having this gigantic pharmaceutical and medical system that's really creating death and disease, that it could be used for some other beneficial purposes that could be so much more creative that you know that we would welcome it, but we don't have that in our current paradigm. So that's why Awake Radio and alchemical connections can help to move forward these alternative, healthful, beneficial processes that are marginalized and suppressed in literature, in mainstream media, and even amongst ourselves when we talk to our family and friends who are not aware of these processes that you know, we have to make it more mainstream. And I think creating that critical mass by discussing it, you know, not just thinking about it, not just intending it, but talking about it is somebody's writing on the. Thank you for talking about my stepdad and my father. Yeah, they are in better places than you know, I would like to have been able to say that, you know, that this was something that they tried. My mother said that if anything happened with her health, and my mother's 79 years old and basically in really good health. She has some eye issues and, some feet issues. She likes to go, drive pretty far to go to the foot doctor because she likes his bedside manner. But basically, she doesn't really have any health problems. She does take some heart medication, but she's trying to get off of that by drinking the distilled water. And she even actually took herself off of it, but part of her cooked diet, I think, contributes to her inability to control that high blood pressure that her doctor seems to use as an excuse for putting her on heart medication, but she doesn't have any heart. Oh, excuse me. She did. She had an aortic valve replacement a few years ago. And, And that was like right before I found out about all this information. So I wouldn't have been much help to her at that point. But I also believe, and I want to say this because I think it was part of my last talk, and it should really be part of this talk, that as I said with my own relationship with my husband that was very abusive, that that our health and our mental state, I think, is thoroughly connected. And I think there's evidence based on quantum consciousness what they're finding out through research and quantum consciousness, that energetically how we feel actually affects our health. And I think most people basically know that stress is caused by the way that you feel. It's environmental, but it can be controlled by being able to control your own mental state. I don't know that we've gotten that far in the mainstream, but that the stress is known cause of heart disease. So with that said, that we can mentally create disease in our body, and I think that's evidenced, and we can do studies on this that are purely qualitative, that show that the repetition of cancer commercials, diabetes commercials, medication treatment for depression, and all these things that we see on the mainstream radio news and literature is basically evidence that putting this information in people's heads who are not aware of the effects of consciousness and creating this disease, this, system of disease, creating illness in people where there was none, simply based on the fact of repetition. And I think, I'm singing to the choir here that we're all, very much aware of. Oh, Cassiopeia, thank you for being here. Namaste for your comments. I see here now you're talking about eye drops. Yeah, that's one of the things that Andrew uses. And also, believe it or not, that a lot of heart medications today are being synthesized through molecule aspects of urine. And it almost seems like laughable when you think about it. But yes, eye drops, murine. It's made from horse's urine. When you tell people that, I've actually had people say that they'd rather, people say I'd rather use the horse's urine than my own urine. And I'm thinking to myself, like, I'm all about, homespun, making things, making things cheaply, making things yourself, not going to the corporations, the corporate, manufacturers, whatever, recycling, buying thing used, all that, homemade gifts. I love all that stuff. So recycling our urine, it's just one of those things that just are on the top of my list. If it works, why not use it? Buy yourself an eyedropper. Put a little urine in a cup. You don't even have to keep it. You can drink a half a quart of water, go to the bathroom 20 minutes later, and, you have an instant curative. Even so for us, and I know this might be hard for some people to believe, it would be difficult for us to ask a child to pee in a cup and then use that as a drink for the child, to cure some, specific, maybe a rash, or, maybe the child has, allergies to certain foods or insects or something. And, that in some cultures could be seen as unacceptable. Andrew, in his wisdom, said, the adult can pee in a cup, whatever, add fruit juice or, you know, something to mask the taste or whatever, and give that to a child. It's not so much diluting, because it's not going to dilute the basic constructs of the molecules in the liquid. Maybe it'll break down the liquids itself, you know, but, it's not going to do anything to really affect the individual molecules or, and I believe there's probably DNA in our urine because of the cellular breakdown. But, you know, there's ways that another person can help the healing process of other people. So, you know, if they were agreeable, and of course that's the alchemical process. I like magic. I like the processes of the occult systems. I like learning about them. I don't use them, beyond, intention, but, I like learning about them. And if someone's in agreement and they're not open to using their own urine and you have this discussion with them, there's no reason why you couldn't use yours, because, on a consciousness level, we're all connected and we are all on the same wavelength, and that, anybody around me and my family could, purposefully, cure me by using their urine. Because, once that situation, has been, you know, made conscious, once we're all aware of, the situation and what the need is, our body goes into manufacturing, you know, that substance, within our blood, and it's, peed out in excess through our urine. And sorry if I'm being crude in my terminology here, but and somehow on an energetic level, that information is transferred to everyone around me. So someone's given the Cassiopeia is giving the mix for the drink, which is beautiful. But you know, this is a process that we can all utilize, that we can all share, and I'm so grateful that I have been privileged to even have this information, to understand the knowledge, the years, the thousands of years history behind this information, the curative effects of this information, you know, and to be able to share this, you know, I feel so honored and so humbled by it that, there isn't anything else. It says do not boil or dilute the urine. Research studies show that boiling urine destroys, and I'm sorry, it's cut off, many of its medical products. And that's what I said from the beginning, boiling. I'm not into cooked food diet. So yeah, I'm right with you, Hypno Steve. But, urea dilution decreases its antibacterial activity. Okay. So don't get me on antibacterial, because that's just, I think that's a farce, but, you know, and one of the things, Santos Bonacci, Andrew really, promotes, distilled liquids, because there's no minerals in there. There's nothing. It's just pure water, H2O. Whatever's might float in from the air, I guess, is part of it. And I've never actually tested it, so I'm assuming it's just hydrogen and oxygen in water when you distill it. So, in your urine, there's lots more things. I think you said 2,000 identified substances. Urine, one of the things that Santos Bonacci was promoting, and he does astrotheology, which I'm totally into, and I totally love his presentations and recommend everybody go to his website. Mr. Astrotheology is his YouTube channel, and check out his videos. But he encourages the use of certain minerals, that there are certain mineral salts or substances that when you're born, that because of the nature of your astrological signs, that your body might be limited and might be of need of. So he gives a whole rundown of how to locate and find out what those minerals are. And what this Hypno Steve is alluding to in his understanding or not, and believe me, I am very not a person who has a scientific background and can only speak from my own experience and what I have researched myself, but that diluting the urine is one of the aspects of what we call was there on the tip of my tongue? When you dilute a substance and you keep diluting it, that process is called something, and it's something that I learned about at a job that I worked in behavioral health with orthomolecular science. It's an alternative to the medical system, and oh my gosh, I can't think of it right now. But that's they put a little bit of the illness in to make the cure. If somebody can refresh my memory on what that's called, that process is called. That's been used for thousands of years. It's a beneficial process, and actually, I kind of think it's akin to the placebo effect. But it's not really the placebo per se, because there's an energetic quality in there. And I think they're also coming up with water studies. You know, Dr. Emoto and his water ice crystals that he said energetically imposed intention on water and then froze it, and that we saw the crystals, and the positive were beautiful and the negative were distorted. Gosh, I can't think of what that word is. You can improve the taste of your urine by eliminating the cooked foods, because it's the cooked foods that taint the taste, that give off the offensive odor, which really it's an olfactory thing, and create that offensive taste that we so loathe in urine. But if you find that you can just eat or drink for even 2 or 3 days, I might say 24 hours, omit cooked foods or strong acrid foods like onions or garlic, or, you know, some people like garlic, it's not a bad thing, but if you could just omit things that you find offensively strong in odor, that your urine will be sweet and won't have that taste, and you'll actually enjoy drinking it, and you'll drink more of it. So I know this from my own experience, and that's part of the process. It doesn't have anything to do with what we call, you know, urine is bad. It's not bad. It's what you put into your body that affects the taste and the smell of the urine. So, you know, by all means, eat what you like. Distilled liquids can flush it out. You know, it's a balancing act with that. But if you want to be able to drink your urine consistently and enjoy it to the point where it has that coconut water sweet taste, maybe even better, you want to really limit the amount of cooked foods that you eat, and maybe the strong, odious vegetables like onions and garlic, and, you know, maybe turnips or stuff like that. And stick to, you know, green apples or fruits, sweet fruits, and, you know, coconut water. And just give yourself a little flush of that distilled liquid process for 24 hours. And you will be absolutely amazed at the difference in the taste. You won't have that problem at all. But as soon as you eat that cooked food, you'll be right back to square one. So, it's a balancing act. It's a process, and, you know, yeah, I'm a cake eater too. I'm trying to look at the chat and talk, and honestly, I'm not that savvy with it yet. But I appreciate everyone's comments, and I really think that you guys are very open-minded and have a lot of interesting information that, you know, that's really beneficial. It would be optimum to be able to drink your urine undiluted. And I think that that's probably, you know, what we're striving for. I also forgot to mention that you probably don't want to drink urine that's been sitting for any, you know, for a couple hours even, because it starts getting alkaline, and that it can be very strong. That's something you want to use externally. And something also that I wanted to add, part of the process of the, getting your body cleansed would be you want to go on a urine or distilled liquid fast, or, you know, drinking just fruit juices and vegetable juices or a mixture thereof, with distilled water, with urine therapy, or, you know, any combination of, or any of those singly. And, you also want to, consider using urine enemas. I know that's, you know, going a little bit deeper into this process, but the rationale for that is because, if you look into the Gerson diet, they found that using coffee, which they found that that's probably the only good use for coffee was as an enema, that the properties in caffeine do something to help eject deposits that are in our intestines and in our, you know, anal tract that need to be cleansed. And the effects are so beneficial that, you know, they have 50 years of using that process with the caffeine. And I guess, I'm not sure how long, urine enemas have been in use, but, through Andrew and myself's, use and evidence that, things come out of your body that, you know, that you couldn't even imagine were deposited in there. But, the evidence is that when you eat cooked food, we find that people have these distended stomachs now. I know there was a lot of evidence on the internet that talked about one of the hormones that produce stress in the body that was a factor in keeping gaining weight. But I don't believe that it has anything to do with basically the hormones, and it could be a combination thereof, but I think it's the process of cooking the food to where it becomes this paste through the process of digestion and attaches to the walls of your intestines. And like any good coating, as it goes through your intestines, it builds up. And just like the plaque in your arteries that builds up, as a result of it keeps attaching to itself, it's magnetic. Just as distilled water and the effects of distilled liquids and urine therapy have of attracting the inorganic. And I think when you cook something, it becomes inorganic, and it attracts those inorganic substances and begins to. Oh, thank you for the picture of the ice crystal. They have the video in the chat that, I forgot what I was saying. But anyway, these things attach to your intestines and to your arteries and clog them up. And that's how we get the illness and disease that we're trying to fight. And I think because we're eating processed food, which is even further cooked, that effect is so much more detrimental to our health and well-being that that that's why distilled liquids and urine therapy are so essential in ensuring our health. Oh, it's homeopathic. That was the word that I was trying to come up with. Hypno-Steve. It's the homeopathic effect is that they take, one concentrated drop of whatever the illness causing factor is, and they put it in seven drops of, let's say, distilled liquid or alcohol. And they keep distilling that. And, they do it maybe seven times, nine times. I'm not sure how many times they do it, but, they find that, that homeopathic process, can be given as a healing treatment. So when you say you shouldn't distill, cook or distill urea, I think it can be used as a homeopathic treatment for, let's say, bee stings, if you're highly allergic to bee stings or eating walnuts, as Andrew says. I actually had a allergic reaction to eating shrimp about a year ago. And I was so frightened by the experience because I was sitting there itching, and I was itching on my forehead, on my neck. Then it started going down my body, and I didn't even know what was happening because I had never had anything like that before. And I think this might have been right after the Fukushima reactor thing. And it was kind of hard to correlate that both things were connected. But I immediately called Andrew and told him what I was experiencing, and he suggested I drink my own urine. And I had inadvertently taken some Benadryl. I took one pill because I had it available. And I can't say that the drinking of the urine impacted the effect. It might have been the Benadryl. But I know that the next time something like that happens, I'm definitely going to just use my urine. I'm not going to reach for any manufactured pharmaceutical because I really want to prove that this is, this is something that works. So, just basically because I had never had that experience before. I think that's why. And I had had a bout of, what we call bed bugs. We were inundated a couple years back and I just had it laying around because it really helped with the itching. Never thought to use urine therapy on that either, but absolutely that would definitely be a 100% instantaneous treatment for either one of those illnesses or symptoms. Okay. So, I guess back to what we want to call cleansing, body cleansing, has anybody, ever used, any type of, enema, whether it be coffee or urine, for treatment, or for total cleansing? Has anybody done a colon cleansing? I don't know. Yes. Okay. No, they're just saying, yes, it's me. But anyway, using this process in conjunction with, doing a water or liquid fast, doing a urine therapy fast, or doing a combination of distilled liquids, distilled water, urine therapy, however you want to do it. Could be for a day, could be for a week. I don't know if that I would recommend anybody doing that, for more than a few days to start, just to get acclimated to it. It could be, very energetic for you. It could also be, very detrimental. When people start on urine therapy to begin with, they do have flu-like symptoms. They break out in rashes. Things happen that are unexpected. So part of the process is to make sure that when you start anything, any kind of fasting, you probably want to make sure other people know that you're doing it, and you also want to make sure that you're very much aware of what the complications might be. Not that they're detrimental. When you start to cleanse your body, things are going to come out of it. And I guess that's the impact of how we have rashes and flu-like symptoms, because our body is, I'm reading the chat and people are making interesting comments about not wanting to try this process. And I completely understand, but in the process of trying to improve your health, basically, let's start with someone who has really impaired health, someone who has diabetes, someone who's going through cancer, someone who might have a muscular sclerosis or some other ailment that, you know, just came on at a certain age. It can be absolutely correlated to their diet and their mental state. Well, this is a place where they can start. They can start with cleansing their body from both ends. Might not want to start both ends, but, you know, using the urine therapy, distilled liquids, distilled water as a purification of the body, a cleansing, and go on a fast for 3 or 4 days. To start and just to see how the process goes, then extend it to 7 days, then extend it to 2 weeks, go on a 14-day fast, then try a 30-day fast. I think this would be difficult for anybody who's working a full-time job like me, or Cassiopeia did the 24/7 for a few months with no effects at all. Until last month, blew open my heart chakra. Oh my God, that is wonderful. And that's one of the interviews I had with Andrew talking about the pineal. But it's quite amazing the energy that people report. You know, the just overall sense of well-being and health. Dave Starbuck, yay, 30-day fast. So what were your results? Did you have any side effects? Did you have any unusual rashes or flu symptoms or anything that, you know, that kind of you thought, well, boy, I'm doing this to feel better, but I don't feel better. when you think of all the years that you've gone putting things into your body, I know I have, that, you know, I love cake and buttercream icing, you know, and I know I've eaten a lot of that over the years, that, you know, that tends to probably stick somewhere. It doesn't have, you know, it's not beneficial to your body. It needs to get out of there and it's probably stuck. When I first started doing this, distilled liquids, I wasn't privy to have a juicer, so mine was more like baby food, processed baby food. I put 7 different greens into the food processor, and I ate that religiously for 3 weeks. And I was very fortunate to, with drinking distilled liquids and urine, that I lost over 30 pounds in 3 weeks. It was just so amazing. You hear Dave says, I came up with spots for a week or two during the healing phase. Yeah, that's just the impurities coming out through your body, absolutely. You know, some of us more, some of us less. And I actually had absolutely no side effects, only I really got tired of eating that mash. And just stuck with the salads, and then ended up buying myself a Green Star juicer, which I absolutely love. It's a lot of work, but it's a wonderful machine. But I've been drinking distilled water for, oh gosh, for over 2 years. I started out using the bottled distilled water. Then when I was in Sarasota, Florida, some of the bottles came back saying that they had been made through the osmosis process. And I wasn't sure if that was a chemical process or not, so I stopped drinking that particular brand of distilled water. But I was getting it just off the grocery store shelf, and I read labels. I read all labels. And I know Andrew recommends just going to Walmart and buying distilled water from them because their shelf life is shorter because, you know, they sell in mass and people go on and just buy it up so it doesn't sit there long. So, and then there was the concern about the plastic bottles, but, you know, I can't speak to all that, but he, you know, he has his own theories on that. I'm totally against plastic. I don't like to use it in anything, but it's hard to get away from it since everything is sold in plastic. Everything is bottled and basically, it's hard to get away from it unless you just eat the distilled raw fruit, liquid diet, whatever. And, so, you know, I have that experience and I know that, that's a process that you can use. You know, it doesn't have to be, you know, this set system. It could be a combination of all these things. It's just, a matter of what your tastes are. Well, Dave is saying he cured nerve damage in his foot. Yeah. And pain in his Achilles tendon. Joint pain in his shoulder went. Lungs regenerated. Limbs flexible. His hair started growing back beautiful. 7 belt notches were lost. Yeah. Yeah. And lines on your face. Yeah. We talked about that earlier about the beauty aspects of urine therapy, but, it works internally. But I wouldn't, I just want to emphasize, any urine that you let sit for more than an hour or so, I just wouldn't recommend drinking unless you're really into that alkaline flavor. I don't think it'll kill you, but, probably make you sick. But it's probably better used in other areas, like as an enema, as a beauty treatment, to regenerate your skin, to heal any, skin, illnesses, foot fungus. You know, that is the cure for foot fungus. And that's one of the things that they do say. Do you add hydrogen peroxide to your water to purify? I don't think adding 2 drops of hydrogen peroxide would purify water. I think once hydrogen peroxide hits the air, it kind of loses its effectiveness. So I would imagine being a hairdresser that once you add it to water, it's absolutely diluted. So I don't know that it does anything to purify it. I know that it's supposed to be a good cleansing agent. Somebody was talking about antibacterial, but, see, yeah, Dave, I'm thinking that after 15 minutes, it starts turning alkaline. I don't know about maybe the nutrients do break down in an alkaline system, but, I know that from the raw food diet that an alkaline diet is more beneficial to the body. So I think it's the difference between the aerobic and anaerobic. So where there's a lot of air present and where there's not. So, maybe in an alkaline system, there's less oxygen. I'm not sure. I'd have to look that up. As I said, I'm not scientifically astute on all this information. It's all coming basically from research that I've done and people that I've talked to. But I know that this effectively works. And it's curative for all illness and dis-ease. And I put the little hyphen between dis and ease because I believe that not only comes from what we ingest and put into our body, but also what is coming from outside of our body, sort of emotions, energetics, constructs the system that's currently in place. H2O2 will help purify water, Cass. They use it rather than chlorine. Well, I'd have to look into that, but yeah, I have used MMS. I have to say that I actually have some here, and it is chlorine. That's basically what it is. It's a sodium chloride, or I might be saying it wrong, but it's something to that effect. And I did try using it, and it was such a horrible chloride. Thank you. It was such a horrible taste. Oh, okay. It was such a horrible taste that, it just was not something that I thought would be beneficial in the long run. But, I would like to tend to think that the reason why MMS works, and not just because it's a purifier, but I think it's because of the belief that it works. And I think that goes back to my first talk last week where, you know, I said that this is an energetic system. Energy abounds all around us. And on a consciousness level, what we believe and what we think has the power to heal just as much as what we ingest. So I'm coming from both systems. And I'm speaking theoretically, philosophically. I don't have any scientific evidence myself to prove that what I'm saying is true, but I'm coming to that conclusion based on a lot of the research that I'm doing. And currently I'm in a PhD program for health psychology, and my thesis statement, and mind you, this is my second class in the program, is based on complementary and alternative medicine for the treatment of postpartum depression in pregnant women. And with that being said, everything that I'm reading, I'm trying to focus on the coherence of consciousness and the what we call the energy that consciousness can't be quantified because it's not matter. It doesn't have any material basis. So the scientific literature is absent or marginalized because of that aspect of consciousness, that there's this energetic level and there's the magnetic, which is probably, it's electromagnetic. So there's a material and a non-material aspect to consciousness. So the non-material aspect is negated, laughed at, marginalized, ridiculed in favor of the orthodox system, which is the pharmaceutical treatments, which are what we know to be antidepressants, which really should not be given to women who are pregnant, but they continually promote that because the pharmaceutical companies are the ones that decide, you know. And I've actually read WHO and UN literature that is really working double overtime to figure out how they can get compliance from pregnant women to use pharmaceuticals. So it's really diabolical on all levels, you know, that we find this. So my research is moving me in the realms of consciousness theory and energy healing, but I'm also trying to look at it on a scientific basis, to where meditation, qigong, acupuncture, all these energy healing processes can be used to heal. So that's where I'm coming up with this construct that illness and disease is really a twofold process. I don't think it's necessarily just what we put into ourselves. Cause we know people who can smoke and smoke and smoke and, you know, live to be in their 80s and never really suffer much or even have any lung problems or whatever. But, and then I know people who never smoked and died from lung cancer. So, I think it's a twofold process that disease is part energetic, on a consciousness level. And it's also physical. So it's internal and external. I think it comes from both systems, both, processes. So it's dualistic, in its effects, and we can treat it, you know, in different ways. We can treat it by the way we think, by the way we look at these things. And, you know, part of the process of urine therapy, distilled liquids and distilled water is really, you know, moving in a direction that's curative. I'm not saying that you can't eat whatever you like and still have good health. I'm just saying that right now in my own mental paradigm that I'm finding that because of the way that I work and live, that I haven't had the luxury of being able to have the fully raw diet or the purely distilled liquids. And that there's some days that I wouldn't want to drink my urine and some days that I just can't. So I go through cycles and I haven't had any health concerns for over a year and a half. I haven't had any fevers or anything. I haven't had any kind of symptoms that any symptoms that cause me to believe that I have any physical problems that I should be concerned about. So I attribute that to consistent distilled water use and also my state of mind. I think healthy. I don't think about disease. And as I said earlier, it's abominable. And I can't stress that enough. The way that this, media construct, I just envelop it and all that is bombarding everyone. I mean, you know, even my future son-in-law about a year and a half ago, he said to me, "What happened to AIDS?" Because they stopped reporting, you know, the constant onslaught of AIDS, you're going to get AIDS, you're going to get AIDS, to, it's all cancer now. They're only the last year or so, they've only been talking about cancer. And it's interesting that people, you know, realize this is that they put this into your head and that, you know, anytime you have a little scratch, an itch, you know, an uncomfortableness, whatever, that, you know, people will go to the doctor and will find things. And I think that's, I have to believe that when they set up the medical system in the United States, that they already knew this. They already knew how consciousness works. They already knew it's a process and it's going to take so many decades to get people entrained in the system. And that I think right now we're in the real material throes of this construct, and that beings that we have this information and that we have the ability to process it, that we can keep disseminating this information and we can just spread it all over and share this lovingly, you know, sympathetically and assuredly inform people that, oh, absolutely. You can't, you know what, Dave, a biological weapon, I think in the construct of on the mental plane, consciousness plane, but I think, and I have to go back, and I don't know why I didn't save it, but one of the things that I heard about how cancer actually is processed in the body is that it's a fungus. and that as a result of the fungus in our body, our cells start to build walls. And that's the process of the, what we call the out of control cells that are cancer. And it's not, it's actually your body trying to protect itself. Now, where I found that information, I can't tell you, how I found that information. It just came to me. Yeah, sickle cell anemia, but I'm thinking that sickle cell anemia in itself might be curable through urine therapy and maybe curable through distilled liquids. AIDS is a bioweapon. AIDS is a construct. Don't even get me started on that. I have a little video on my YouTube page. I'm trying to think of the name of the doctor, Duesenberg. He had been a proponent of AIDS research in the beginning from when it first started. And what he found is that we have 250, we'll just call them viruses. There's a word for them. I guess you call them extinct, or they're dormant viruses that live within the body. And one of them has the characteristics or whatever of what they call the HIV virus. And what's happening is when people have low immunity, or people are drug addicts, or usually people who are drug addicts have, you know, unprotected sex, but it's not so much the unprotected sex, it's the numerous sex partners. Probably someone who is a prostitute or something like that. And people who just have very low immune systems, that what he found was that there's the marker, the HIV, that exists in people. It's not in everybody. That's why everybody doesn't test positive. But people have this marker for HIV, and then they have a low immune system, and the individual might, intravenous drug user, or just be a drug addict generally, have a low immune system and just do things that basically contribute to a bad immune system. Okay, Dave is arguing with me about the fungus, and I'm not saying that it is true. I'm just trying to get this thing out about AIDS, that I have to find that information, and basically I really do want to find that. Oh my God, anthrax. No, it's not anthrax. But anyway, the only people who get tested for AIDS are the ones that have the low immune system, and the ones who have the high sexual activity, whatever you want to call it. Not everybody in the world is being tested for AIDS. If everybody was tested, then we would find that people have these markers for AIDS. Then they get on these retroviral medications that were in the 70s, were supposedly used to treat cancer, but were found to be so toxic that they were taken off the market. They were completely removed from the market. So we know that ATZ that was used to fight AIDS or HIV, whatever, is actually the ingredient that's killing the people. It's not any effects of what people are diagnosed with AIDS or HIV. It's actually the medication. That's why people continue to take medications and take more, and they don't live. And I think part of that too, and I think if I had a higher medical degree and I had access to labs and I could do all this research and not just do it in my head, because I'm really good at collecting these connections, that you would find that, yeah, if somebody believes in their mind and their heart that they have an incurable illness, they're taking medication that's actually toxic to their body. And that combination is so detrimental that, it's unbelievable or it's not hard to believe that, you know, somebody would die within, so many years. So that's AIDS in a nutshell. And I don't, nobody can change my mind on that. It's not that I'm not open to it, but I, but the way this, Dr. Duesenberg was so, he was stripped of his, credentials. I mean, he was premier, biologist, and he, you know, he was the person to go to for, you know, this information. But once he changed from that AIDS construct, once he tried to show that, you know, this is showing something different, he was silenced, literally. So he was, all his funding was stripped, everything. So, you know, they say follow the money when you want to find out information. So, you know, follow where the money was taken away from the people who are, you know, studying this stuff. And AIDS is anthrax mixed with two other pathogens found in animals. Maybe one was a monkey factor. I don't remember exactly. I think it could be probably shown that the AIDS virus is prevalent in that monkey species, and that because it's prevalent in that monkey species, that I could justify my comments and say that, yeah, it's probably found in humans. and it's a natural part of the constituents of the human body and how it's developed. Just like, AIDS in monkeys doesn't cause the illness, but it's a factor in their whatever. So with that said, I mean, there's so many things we can talk about and so many, you know, ways we can look at this. Cancer is not a fungus. It's an act in the same way as fungus. That is, it feeds on blood sugars and the body walls off the neoplastic cells with healthy cells causing what we call a humor. Okay. Or a tumor. I'm sorry. I'm right on top of it and I can't read it. Yeah, I guess that kind of, it goes with what I was saying, and thank you, Dave Starbuck, and that, I'm not saying that cancer is the fungus, but I think that what we call cancer is this process that, have I seen this yet? I don't know what that is. It's too small for me to see, so maybe green monkeys, okay. But anyway, you know, these are all things that we can continue the discussion about and we can look more into and maybe find people who are actually researching this in labs and maybe, you know, finding what needs to be found out about the truth of all these things. But I think it's something that we can keep an open mind about. It's something that we continue to look at and we can move forward on in this discussion. But back to the urine therapy and distilled liquids, that whether it is or is not, that we can use it to heal. We can use it to cure our bodies. And that's basically why I want to move forward on Awake Radio, what I want to promote, what I'm looking for as far as conversation from other people. You know, let's get this dialogue going. Let's spread it. Let's make it bigger. Let's get more people involved. Okay. They might not get funding for this in labs, but there are people who have done this research and maybe they got cut off, but we can find evidence of this stuff in places and we can help support research, whether it be in a lab or whether it be in people's homes where they're suffering from what's clinically diagnosed as whatever symptoms manifesting as whatever disease as it's diagnosed, that I will be happy to watch this green monkeys. Dr. Moraes Heilman, American doctor, admits to creating AIDS virus and adding it to vaccines. Okay. I'll look at the date too when that was posted or whenever this person supposedly did it. I know there's evidence that anthrax was manufactured. And I have no doubt that in some aspect, the AIDS virus, but I don't know if you've read a little bit further that there is no Dr. Hellman. Okay. Thank you. There is no evidence that HIV AIDS, kills people. What they're finding is that the complications of a compromised immune system is why people are dying. There is no evidence that people are dying from HIV/AIDS. So I guess that's where I'm getting my information. Okay, thank you, Dave. Yeah, well, I had asked about that information earlier. It's going to be on November 20th that Andrew Norton Weber and Dave will be speaking at the Brick House in London on November 20th. And I'm encouraging everyone to buy tickets. Because I think that will help to generate interest and also secure the Brick House for their conversation. So with that said, I have about a little over 15 minutes left. I haven't exhausted my understanding of distilled liquids or urine therapy. But I think if there's any questions or, you know, anything that people want to ask or any anecdotal evidence that they have of their own, that would be greatly appreciated. Maybe Mr. C, maybe he has some anecdotal evidence of his own urine therapy treatment. Are we still on?
Yes, we are, Kaz. Kaz, sorry, I'm looking at the chat as well. Sorry, Chrissy. Well, yes, you know, I mean, I think along with a lot of others, the main point of note when you begin it in the early days, especially if you're suffering from this beforehand, is a sort of energy boost that comes on very soon after you start the process. But something you said earlier on in your show there, Chrissy, on which you're doing a most excellent job, I have to say, is that anyone thinking of taking this up would be well advised, as Chrissy said earlier, to go through a bit of a diet change. Cut out the fats and the sugars as much as possible, and you're going to have a much more pleasurable experience in embarking on urine therapy, because taste is everything.
yes.
So
that's a strong point. Is we can eat whatever we want. I really am a strong proponent. In fact, as I said from the beginning, I started eating beef, and I really hadn't been eating beef for years. So I don't think it's so much, you know, that don't eat this or don't eat that. I think everything in moderation is wonderful, and taste is everything. But I think when you want to go on the urine therapy, I think you have to be mindful that the food that we ingest actually colors and flavors the urine, and that can make the difference between whether you're going to continue on this process or not. So
absolutely,
it's absolutely, you know, imperative that you consider a 24-hour liquid fast before you maybe even start.
I would have to concur implicitly there. And stay off the baked beans.
Oh, they sound good.
Yeah. I think that's a question named at you there, Chrissy, from Dave Starbuck, whoever he is. He might have missed it, but what effects have you noticed yourself?
Oh, if for drinking?
I think he's relating to the UT there, yeah.
Yeah, I think I kind of said it earlier, is that I think in the last year and a half, I haven't had and coffee, yeah. I haven't had any health concerns. The only thing that I can tell you specifically was that bad reaction to the shrimp that I unfortunately took the Benadryl for. But other than that, I used to be sick. Like every winter, I would get one or two really bad 2-week flus or sinus infections or bronchial infections. In fact, I was a smoker over 21 years ago. And when I quit, I was diagnosed with the beginning stages of emphysema. Now, mind you, I haven't been tested. I don't go to the doctors to get checkups or physicals or any kind of blood work and stuff done. But the last time I had to go to the doctors was when I started this current job a year ago. And consequently, they did do blood work. And the only thing they found was that there was a lot of blood in my urine. And before I get into that, I just want to say that they found that I was in absolute health, that all my symptoms were wonderful, but the big concern was the blood in the urine. And I went home, and when I was a child, I was about 11 years old, I was diagnosed with nephritis, which is a disease of the kidneys. And I had this doctor who 2 years in a row took this apparatus and shoved it through my back into my kidney. It was like the size of a pencil that had some kind of thing on the inside that actually grabs a piece of your kidney and takes it out as a biopsy. And she did that to me twice, within a 12-month period. And couldn't find anything wrong with my kidneys, but they kept finding that I had blood in my urine. And so the suggestion was to drink more water or drink, more fluids. Kind of flush them through. And a year ago when I left that clinic where I had the blood work done for this job, I don't know why they had the blood work done, but it was basically urine testing and they did blood work for some ungodly reason. I still don't know why. Maybe because they have a lot of people who are from foreign countries and they're just testing for everything to make sure that people aren't coming and they don't tell you what they're testing for. So anyway, I went home thinking, if there's that much blood in my urine, knowing what I know about urine therapy, that my urine is blood. It is my blood. My blood comes, my urine comes from my blood system. The bloodstream is the source of, from the kidney to the blood, through the lungs and the heart, and now through the bladder, that it would make sense that there would be blood in my urine, because that's where it's coming from. And it's not necessarily a sign that there's something medically wrong with me. So, and I think that buys back into my premise that it's energetic consciousness. That's the twofold aspect of disease and illness that, doctors trying to find illness, can use that as an excuse for why. It's been a year. I haven't had my urine tested, but I'm imagining that if I had the blood work and the urine tested again, they might come up if I don't drink a lot of water before I take the test, find that there's blood in my urine, and also that my labs would come back perfect, that I wouldn't have any problems. So,
were you noticing any visible signs of this alleged blood content in your urine?
No, well, your urine is dark when you don't drink a lot of liquids. And I'm imagining that the color in your urine is partly from, the factors that are in your bloodstream and that, your blood cells, red blood cells, white blood cells, whatever other wonderful things are in there, whatever you eat, all those things are factored into your urine. And and if you drink the recommended gallon plus a day of distilled liquids or water or even your own urine, your urine's going to be clearer and, you know, it's going to, you know, be more palatable. But that's the only thing that I notice, and that the less water I drink, and unfortunately, and I have to admit this because, you know, here I am promoting all this, and I really do drink a lot of water, but when I'm working, they just made it mandatory that nobody can drink water at their desk or any liquids. They can't have any food or liquids at their desk. And I work in a 128-bed, basically nursing home facility. I'm supervising on one floor 74 individuals and 27 workers. And that's on one floor, and I'm working both floors and double that. I'm walking around the whole time. I'm not stopping to drink. You know, I basically only drink when I'm feeling thirsty or have that headache symptom coming on, when my body's telling me you better get some fluids, and then I'll chug a whole quart of my distilled water, which I carry with me, and they all laugh at me because I bring it to work. Yes, Steve, I absolutely agree. And so I hope that's answering your question. The only symptoms that I have, it's basically because of my employment right now is not beneficial to my overall sanity, but it's a job, and I'm very grateful to have it, and it does pay the bills. But I'm also trying to move in other directions. So, you know, drink more water and drink more distilled liquids, distilled water. Some people use, the osmosis, I think it's the osmosis process.
The reverse osmosis process, yeah, it's just a multi-stage filtration system, which is certainly not to the level of distilled water, but, you know, it probably is the closest alternative to it.
Yeah, and also with the distilled water process, that it's really important to use a carbon filter before you distill the water, because there's VOCs, which I'm not quite clear what they are, but I know what they taste like.
Yeah.
And they do impact the taste and probably impart a volatile.
Yes, indeed. I also believe it's not a good idea to use plastic in your distillers either. Opt for the glass alternative.
Absolutely.
Right. Well, 7 minutes left of your slot there, Chrissy. One question came in just at the start of your show from another Awake Radio host, actually, simply Steve, who's on up after you, was asking to know a little bit more about the alchemical connections that you're affiliated with. I don't know if you can expand a bit on that at all.
Yeah, well, I guess my understanding of alchemy is synthesis of processes, and I think we've basically been talking about that today. We've talked about changing diet, the implications of health and well-being, and the medical system and its impact on health and the consciousness constructs. I think all that's alchemical, and even if we don't have the beakers and we're not cooking things and blending materials together to make some other concentrated substances, we're doing that in our bodies, we're doing that in our minds, and we're doing that collectively here in our conversation. So understanding what I do of alchemy, I know that it's a synthesis of processes, and I believe that's what this radio show is all about. We're going to synthesize information. We're going to synthesize our experiences from the past and the present, and we're going to try to concoct them in such a way as to materialize a better future, which I think is playing out now. The fact that we're even talking about these things, I don't have people on the chat line going, ew, F that, or, you know, saying, no way, you're wrong, you know, and all this other stuff, you know, is really a metaphysical evidence that this alchemical process is working. that we are coming together on a consciousness level. It's not always a physical level, and we are making this new paradigm. We are creating something that's probably been up ours, part of us forever, but just hasn't manifest in the material. So I think that's where the alchemical connections are coming from, and I think that's why I tried to say earlier, I'm really into metaphysics, and I'm really into the occult, and I'm really into magic, and I'm really into consciousness and quantum physics and all this science stuff that, you know, might be hidden or might be difficult for people to understand, you know, electronics, electromagnetic energy, all these things, and how they can all be synthesized and put all together, and how we can make sense of it in our day-to-day lives. And I think that is basically where the alchemical connections stems from, where it is and where it's going. And I hope that answers Steve's question about, you know, how did I come up with that, or what does that have to do with my conversation?
I reckon it does too, Chrissy, and I for one certainly look forward to hearing more about that as your shows go on. Well, that kind of brings this nicely up to just about time to play out with a tune to give Simply Steve time to plug his cables in, and I'll just leave it to you to say cheerio to the folks until next Saturday. And just a reminder to yourself to have a look in your Skype window to download the software program I've put in so we can get you set up with your own broadcasting stuff.
Well, thank you, Mr. C. And I want to thank you, all the participants, in this wonderful two-hour discussion on urine therapy and distilled liquids. It was really off the cuff, and I was really unprepared because I wasn't sure I was going to start this week, but I'm so happy that I did. And I want to repeat that Andrew Norton Weber and Dave, I'm not sure what his last name is, but Dave, probably the co-founder of Awake Radio, will be speaking at the Brick House in London on November 20th. They're having a distilled waters conference, and I want to hope that everybody will participate, and I'm encouraging people to buy their tickets now so they can secure the venue. And again, thank you everybody for listening. This is Chrissy McMahon for Alchemical Connections on my premiere radio debut.
Great stuff, Chrissy.